Our wonder, our transport, when Jesus. And man, what blessing, if you are trusting victory for anything else but Jesus, you trust him this. Everything is encompassed in the person of Christ.
Amen.
I love good Baptist doctrine that everything in salvation is encompassed in the person of Christ.
Amen. That's right.
That's why he could say to the thief on the cross, today you will be with me in paradise. He has all authority. It is good. It's a pleasure and a blessing for New Testament Church to host the monthly fellowship. We're glad everyone is here. We're going to take our time and just praise the Lord. And the ladies have something fixed up nice downstairs. But we want to do our first business of praising the Lord.
Amen.
You know, I think a lot of the Pentecostals have about taken our praise away from us. That belongs to the Lord's people. And we shouldn't be afraid to do that. We shouldn't be able to give him the honor due his name. He did for you what no one else could do. So what could you possibly withhold from him? We'll begin with special singing. I'm looking back to see all the churches that are about us. We'll start with Homestead Baptist Church. Thank you. solo, brother. All right, so then I guess it is Sunnyview Baptist Church. Moving back this way, pulling from both sides.
Storms in our lives. And this song tells about about how bad those storms can get, but there's one thing about being in a storm. The Lord Jesus Christ and God who watches over us.
Amen.
He takes care of us, and so we'll be safe when the storm passes by.
That's amen.
So y'all listen to it, pray for us, and I hope you enjoy this song.
Thank you.
supper tonight over at the house, Brother Mark brought up the fact that he had to teach his children what fellowship was. Because most church groups are not as blessed as we are.
Right.
And I think we've gotten a little used to it, and we don't appreciate it like we should, but if the nearest church to you that was sound in the faith church is about 4 hours, then you would appreciate what we have here.
Yeah, yeah.
So I believe that we're beginning to understand now. Because it's like, is it a conference? I'm like, no, it's not a conference. Is it a revival? No, it's not really a revival. So it's good that our children understand that concept. You don't even have to tell them. They're like, oh, we have a point of fellowship. All right. Anyone I missed for singing special? All right. Then I'm going to ask my wife to come back and my father-in-law. We're going to sing page 2. Let everybody stand and get stretched. And then we'll begin. Still today from that work, and but it's a long time ago. And he was younger, and so was I. He was really young. I was younger, but I wasn't really young. But Lord's used him a lot of his church, and we trust that you have come praying for him tonight. What we stand in need of is to hear from the Lord. All right, Brother Mark, you come and preach whatever the Lord's given.
Good evening. It's good to be here. Brother Lafferty mentioned the blessing of fellowship, and for many years we were without that blessing. And I mentioned it at the last fellowship that we had on the other side of the lakes, and how much of a tremendous blessing it is to us. We're not used to it yet, and I hope that we don't ever get used to it.
Amen.
We enjoy getting together. We enjoy the singing a lot. We very much enjoy the singing, appreciate the singing. And really, to a certain degree, that has been unique to this fellowship in many ways. And I felt we all seemed to feel the Spirit of the Lord in the last fellowship we had on the other side of the lakes. Everybody expressed that. And there was a bit more singing than normal. And we had a few more congregationals than normal. And somebody actually said to Brother Derek, our song leader, said, "Thank you for the fourth song."
Amen.
We got in a rut of just always singing three
songs
right. And sitting down. And we get in ruts like that sometimes. And I would pay money to be here tonight. I would. If it weren't for the fact that the highest price has already been paid.
Amen.
We could be here tonight singing the songs that we've sung that have been a tremendous blessing. I appreciate every one of them. And I appreciate the fellowship we had before we came over. And I ate too much. Hopefully that doesn't slow us down this evening. But if you have your Bibles tonight, if you'll turn to Psalms 37. Psalms 37, begin in verse number 1. "Fret not thyself because of evildoers." There are several passages in the New Testament that explain to us that in the last days there's going to be more and more of them.
Right.
It terrified me that we could even have an election like we had.
Right.
It went better than I thought it was going to, but it still was a completely sad commentary.
You're right. Amen.
Amen.
And it just holds true to what Paul said in Timothy and what Peter said concerning the last days, that the Spirit speaks. Paul told Timothy, the Spirit speaks expressly.
Right.
"In the last days, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." And we are living in those days. He says here in Psalms, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be envious against workers of iniquity." And there's some comfort in verse 2, "For they shall soon be cut down like the grass."
Amen.
Soon. It will be quickly. The Lord will deal with these things. "They shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as a green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good." And if we had a title this evening, we'll take it from verse 3. And it would be "Trust and Do." Trust and do. There seems to be something about trusting that causes many to trust and not do. Trust and not do. Trust and hide. Trust and a lot of other things. And it struck me as I read verse number 3, "Trust in the Lord and do good. When you can't understand things, when things look obscure, brother sang the song, "Till the Storm Passes Over."
Amen.
The song mentions a dark midnight, obscurity and darkness, times that we can't sense the presence of the Lord. Job said, I look this way, he's not there. I look this way, he's not there. In the time of his trouble, in the time of his difficulty, trust in the Lord and do good. Something that's inseparable from trusting in the Lord. Something that's inseparable from trust and faith is waiting. It's inherent in that word. It's inherent in that concept. It cannot be separated. And really, whenever I think of Psalms 37, I think of waiting on the Lord. It's mentioned three times. It's mentioned in verse number 7, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Wait patiently for Him. And fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. It shows up again in verse number 9. For evil doers shall be cut off, but they that wait upon the Lord,
amen,
they shall inherit the earth. And again in verse 34, wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalt thee to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, thou shalt see it.
Amen.
So part of this trusting is the concept of waiting. There's time involved in trust.
That's right.
You cannot separate time from trust. It's built into that. You are trusting something that is not happening right now. You're trusting that it shall happen at some point. It cannot be separated from that concept. And tonight as we look at this, we'll see, we'll consider what to do while we wait. Mm-hmm. What to do while we wait. Trust in the Lord, we see in verse 3, and do. Mm-hmm. Trust and do. What do we do while we wait? There's a number of commands given just here in this passage. We're going to look at those this evening. Following verse number 3, he said, trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily shalt thou be fed. It's part of your continuing in the land. It's part of your success in the land. Trust and do. And then he begins to name some things. Notice verse number 4. He gives a command. Delight thyself also in the Lord. What do we do while we're waiting? You know, many times we're in positions of waiting in our lives for various things. All of us are waiting for the Messiah to come and rule and reign upon this earth and make things right. We hope some things get made right in Washington, but I'm not holding my breath for everything I'd like to see.
Right.
It's already been laid out that many of the things that believers would like to see would not happen.
Right.
We don't believe those things to come from a particular party anymore. They're not going to.
You're right.
We're waiting for the Lord to come and rule and reign on this land. But many times we're waiting for other things. All through our lives, we're waiting for different things. Many have been struck with different types of storms, different types of difficulties. Again, I'll keep referencing that storm until the storm passes over.
Amen.
It's so fitting to think of that song. First of all, to think of the word until. Until. That's a word that's in our Bible a lot.
You're right.
Until. But there's something that's done until. There are things that happen until. We're not just to sit down until. We're not just to hide until. There were times that Israel hid. There were times that Israel was hiding in rocks and dens and caves.
And so, while we're waiting, and perhaps many times we're waiting for a storm to pass over, there's a particular storm. Sometimes we're just waiting for direction.
Right.
The Lord has moved our family around a lot, and that's not easy. A lot of times we're waiting on, in the past, many times we're waiting for a house to sell. We're waiting for a job to come through. We're waiting for different parts of the puzzle, for God to bring different parts of the puzzle together. We had a very hard time searching for houses in our last two moves. Our family's larger. It's been difficult moving the last several times. Many times we're stuck, what feels like we're stuck in waiting. Sometimes we have health conditions that come upon us sovereignly. There's nothing we can do about them, and it sidelines a whole part of our life. It sets us aside, and we feel like there's so many active things that we cannot do, and we're stuck waiting for healthier days, waiting for a healing, waiting for a miracle, waiting for a job, waiting for a house, waiting for different things, waiting for a situation to resolve in our lives, waiting for a relationship issue to resolve, waiting for someone to change, waiting for different things. What do we do in those waiting times? We serve the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
The word waiting, it's an interesting word, because if you look up where did the word that's translated come from, you know, and sometimes those are just endless rabbit trails that leads you nowhere,
right?
And we're not close enough to know enough about the language many times to understand. You can go to a lexicon or something like that and look up a word, and as I did, the word wait, and you find that it can be translated actually to wait for something, or a rope. I'm like, oh, well, those are similar. But oftentimes when I find something like that, I think, well, what is the connection? What is there? How? There must have been a certain way that they could use that word that I don't understand. And after a fair amount of research, I found that the word lends itself to the type of waiting of building a spider web, of spooling and winding and making a type of web. Well, that's a different idea of waiting. That's an expectant waiting. That's a waiting that's full of some action. And so let us begin to look at the action of this waiting. This is not a dormant waiting. So what do we do while we're waiting? The first thing we see, verse number 4, delight thyself also in the Lord.
Amen.
To rejoice in the Lord. To have joy in the Lord. One of the first temptations of waiting is for you to grow sour against the Lord. Why hasn't the Lord done what I am waiting for in my life? Lord, why haven't you sold my house? Why haven't you given me the job? Why haven't you healed me of this thing? And that's what Satan wants to happen. He wants you to grow sour against the Lord.
You're right.
While you're waiting. Determined to worship God while you're waiting. Oh, what power you will have over the devil when you determine to worship God while you're waiting.
Yes.
I am going to worship the Lord. I'm going to delight in Him. He is a wonderful God, even though I can't feel Him. I can't sense Him right now. I wish He would do different things, but I'm going to worship Him.
Amen.
While I'm waiting. I'm going to look to Him. I'm going to express my love and delight in the Lord while I wait.
Amen.
So the psalmist said, delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Shall is somewhat future tense. It's you're going to have to wait sometimes.
Yep.
But to delight in the Lord, to find joy in the Lord. What did Paul and Silas do? while they waited behind bars.
Right. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
What power you have that moment over the devil. You've had victory in that moment when you determine to worship the Lord despite your waiting. Move on to verse number 5 and we'll look at our next command. Each of these are given as a command. It says, commit thy way unto the Lord.
Amen.
Commit thy way unto the Lord. Look at your day, look at your life, and commit it to the Lord. Lord, I'm waiting for this to happen. I'm waiting for that to happen. What Satan wants you to do is to move into a mode, first of all, of sourness against God. Next of all, he wants you to move into a mode, and this is what comes upon me, of just frozen inaction. You're just frozen,
right? Amen.
Without action. You just begin to go through the motions of life.
Right.
You come to church. And you keep telling yourself in your mind, my life will change when God does this. My life will change when this happens, when that happens. Things will be different when this. And you keep putting off your life. You keep putting off making changes to your soul until God does something. That's what Satan wants you to do.
You're right.
He wants you to be spiritually frozen. There are people today that are spiritually frozen.
Amen.
They have all kinds of good excuses. When this changes, when that changes, when this happens, when my account looks like this, when this looks like that, then I'm going to get down to business. We're going to do this and we're going to do that. They have tons of good intentions, but right now they're frozen.
Right.
And they believe it to be acceptable to be frozen right now. He says, commit thy way unto the Lord. Lord, what do you want me to do today? I would like you, Lord, to do this and this. I'm waiting for this and this, but Lord, you tell me. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And many times the answer is very simple. Just be a good Christian. Be a good father, be a good mother, be a good husband, wife, church member. Commit your way unto the Lord. He shall bring it to pass. Verse 6, and he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. He shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth thy righteousness and thy judgment as the noonday. He'll bring you out of that obscure darkness. He'll bring you into the new day. Notice verse number 7, our next command, and this is a hard one for me. Rest. That's a different level of trust.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different level of trust when you rest in the Lord. I can say, Lord, I'm going to obey. Lord, I'm going to follow. But I'm going to be a stressed out, angry mess the whole time.
Right.
That's right.
I can be that way.
Yeah.
I'm going to be up all night scheming and planning and rest in the Lord.
Amen.
You know, as we had a study recently at our church, we studied David's mighty men. And there's some interesting stuff in there.
Amen.
There's some really... I was just so thankful for that study that the Lord gave us. And one of the men... There's a number of them that were just given their name. We don't know anything about them. And so in an effort to bring honor to their cause and to not just pass over the ones that were not given a story, I researched them as much as I could. I dug into their names. I dug into their parents' names. I dug into the village they were from. And we found that there was one whose name literally meant snorer. His name meant snorer. But he was a warrior. He was a man on the battlefield. Likely, he was sleeping in tents. This is not the place to snore. This is not the place you want the enemy to find you, to hear you. You want to be careful. You're not going to sleep well, but he had a reputation of snoring in the camp. When other people could not sleep, there he is over there snoring away. He doesn't care. And I tell you, snoring
is not technically a measure of faith. But, there's a bunch of us that are starting to go, oh, I'm pretty spiritual. But snoring was a sign that he was asleep.
You can fake sleep, but this fellow was snoring. Rest. And it's a command. These are commands. You know, we feel like resting in the Lord, that's optional. There's optional things in the Bible. You know, we have to be Sovereign Grace Baptists and we have to look a certain way. You know, resting in the Lord, some of these, like, not coveting, things that people can't really prove, are optional. These are commands.
That's right.
Amen.
These are commands, just like anything else. These are commands. Rest in the Lord.
Amen.
You have a responsibility, and if you've not been doing it, you're guilty. You're guilty before the Lord if you're not resting in the Lord.
Amen.
And I guarantee you, we've all been guilty.
Yep.
That's right.
All been guilty. All been guilty of wringing our hands. What did he start off the chapter with? Fret not. I am a fretting mess many times. Fretting mess. Fretting over the election. Fretting over the checkbook. Fretting over my job. Fretting. There's a certain level of faith that we need to reach whereupon we can rest in the Lord. What does that speak of? It speaks of our level of confidence and belief in the promises of God and in the character of our Savior. When we fail to rest, we call the question to the world the character of our Savior.
Amen, you're right.
It goes back to the first command, delight thyself in the Lord. Because failing to delight in the Lord and failing to rest in the Lord calls into question the character of our Savior, who has never given us one reason to question Him.
You're right.
I told my church long ago, you're going to get so tired of hearing me preach from the song in our songbooks, how firm a foundation.
Amen.
So very scriptural. It comes out of the book of Isaiah. But it asks the question, how firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in His excellent word? It's very firm.
Amen.
But we don't live like it's very firm. We live like it's very shaky. We live like it's very uncertain. I don't really know if this is... And that's what we signal. That's what we're signaling to the world. We're signaling to the world, I don't know if you can believe my God. We're signaling to our kids, I don't know if you can believe our God.
Right.
Yes, we go to church, yes, we do these things, but I'm not sure you can trust our God. Mm-hmm. Our life signals that.
You're right.
We've all been guilty of signaling that. And then one day we look back at our churches and we look back at our families and we look back and we go, what happened? We've been signaling all along. You can't really trust God. All along. We've sent out those signals to our coworkers, to our neighbors, to our children. You can't really trust our God. We have to move. Over here, there's no churches over here. It's what we have to do to get a better job. We signal our children. We can't trust our God.
Yep.
Different things that we do in our lives, we're signaling all along. We can't trust our God.
Amen.
And so we have a responsibility. It's a command. It is an encouraging thing, but it's more than an encouraging thing to rest in the Lord. It's that we must.
Amen.
We must rest in the Lord. And then we see that word again there in verse 7, and wait patiently for Him. Again, we're given the counter command. The counter command is, fret not thyself. Fret not thyself. It's interesting the way that's worded. It's like you're doing it to yourself. Fret not thyself. In other words, you have a responsibility to put the brakes on fret when it starts to come. Martin Luther was once asked about tempting thoughts, and fretting is a tempting thought.
Amen.
Lust, covetousness, there's a number of fretting thoughts. A skeptic came to him one time and they said, but you can't keep any thought from coming into your head. Satan can put a thought there, somebody else can put a thought there, you can't keep a thought from coming into your head. And his response was, you can't keep birds from flying over, but you can keep them from building a nest in your hair.
Amen.
And there's some truth in that. You can't keep birds from flying over. But you don't have to let them nest. So, fret not thyself. Because of him who prospereth in his way. When he speaks of him who prospereth in his way, there's another element to this that we've ignored tonight. But we need to bring it in. And that's envy.
Amen.
And this compounds the issue. Because we look around and we say, not only would I like God to do this in my life, and I'm wondering why He hasn't, but I'm wondering why He has for him.
Yeah.
I'm wondering why He has for her. Remember how that the barren would be so grieved by those that had children. Fret not thyself. There's a temptation. And what happens when envy enters the equation is that we now give ourselves license to stay where we're at. When we perceive the system to be unfair, we give ourselves license to quit. And many today have given themselves license to quit. And there's tons of problems with this. We don't have time to go into them all. But there are tons of problems with that line of thinking. One of the first problems that comes to mind is the fact that the Bible says, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man.
Right, amen.
Your brother has troubles that are not your troubles, but they are common troubles. Mm-hmm. You can't, you know, we look around today and we all have our best foot forward tonight. But you don't know what somebody else is carrying around. Maybe you're carrying around financial difficulty and you look and see that somebody drives up in a shiny collar and you think, boy, it must be nice to be them. You don't know what they're carrying around.
Right.
You don't know what other areas of their life God has let Satan touch and work in. You don't know. Emotional areas, physical areas. And so when we begin to allow envy to come into the situation, into the equation, it has a multiplier. We allow that to enter into the equation. And now it's not just our relationship and the Lord and what we're waiting for the Lord to do with us. Now we're looking and going, well, why is He doing that with them? First of all, you don't know where they're at in their period of waiting. You don't know where they're at in their timeline. Maybe they've been waiting a long time. You don't know where they are. cannot do that. And he tells you not to do that. Fret not thyself because of him that prospereth in his way. You need to leave that alone. That's not your business. You have your own contract with God. Remember that parable that Jesus told about hiring laborers to come? Mm-hmm. And everybody starts getting upset about the other laborers. He said, whoa, wait a minute. Did I keep my contract with you? You and I had a contract. Don't worry about everybody else. Don't look at everybody else. Let's move on now. And very fittingly, the next command comes, verse 8. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. There are some things, as we mentioned, some thoughts, there's some things you have to put the brakes on. While you're waiting, you're going to have to control your thoughts. You're going to have to put the brakes on certain things. You have to put the brakes on anger, on wrath, on fretting. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. There's a great temptation. Remember, I mentioned that when you begin to look around, you begin to give yourself license. Mm-hmm. What do you give yourself license to do? Wrong. Mm-hmm. Wrong. There are people that believe when the going gets tough, God is going to, it's okay for you to break the commands. You know what? If life is hard, you can go ahead and break the Sabbath. You know, if life is hard, you can go ahead and not tithe for a while. If life is hard, you can go ahead and whatever, fill in the blank.
Amen.
People give themselves license.
Yeah, that's right.
While they're waiting.
Amen.
To do things that they wouldn't have done. I'm in sales. I've been in sales for 15 years. One of the things they teach you in sales is that as a good salesperson, you need to give your purchaser license to buy. Emotional license. It's a tactic. That person that comes and him haws around the lot and looks at cars and or whatever the situation is, they're him hawing around, and most of the time it's not that they already don't like something. So they're trying to get a license. They're trying to justify it in their mind. And they're going to justify it on different bases. They're going to justify it based on the perceived value that they get out of it. In other words, is it worth what I'm paying? Is it a good deal for what I'm getting? And there's different ways you can get to that. You can make the car feel and seem like it has greater value to them, or you can make the price feel like the price is much lower to them. And there's different ways that you make them feel value or different things, but the goal is you're trying to give them mental license to purchase. Like, one of the best ways to give somebody in my industry mental license to purchase is we say, you know what, you really need to change your glasses this year. You need to do that. It's been a big change. It's necessary. And they'll say, okay, if you tell me that that's what I need to do, I wanted another pair. They say one of the biggest failures to get optical sales is when the doctor walks out and says, you know, there's not really that big a change. All of a sudden, license goes away. They're like, oh no, I really wanted a new frame, but the doctor says I didn't have a change, and now I can't do it. I can't justify it in my brain. It's all very psychological. But on the other side of that, Satan is the great salesperson, and he's trying to sell you and give you license in your mind to sin. License in your mind to break the commands. Is that not what he did with Eve?
Right.
He came to her, he sold her, he gave her license to sin.
Right.
And that's what happens. And it's a great temptation while we're waiting. And so we have to be aware of Satan's tactics. And I don't know, again, what you're waiting on tonight. Could be some storm, some health issue, or just the coming of the Lord and waiting for things to change in this world. Whatever you're waiting on tonight, understand these temptations of waiting. Now the psalm somewhat switches gears for a few verses. He says in verse 9, "For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth." He's reminding them of the end. Reminding them of what's going to happen to the wicked, what's going to happen to his people. Verse 10, he gives the appeal again of the time frame of the waiting. He says, "For yet a little while." Listen, he says, the time is short. He's already made that plea back in verse number 2 in his introduction. He said, "For soon, soon, a little while," it's a short while, "and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently seek his place, and he shall not be." And again, you see a lot of shall nots with the wicked, and then a lot of shalls concerning God's people. Verse 11, in contrast, "But the meek shall." See the difference? "But the meek shall." And again, hidden in that word "shall" is the concept of time. That's a future tense word. "Shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace."
Amen.
Another verse of that song that is sung tonight speaks of the clouds rolling forever from the sky. That day's coming quickly.
Mm-hmm.
You can't imagine that. It's so stormy down here. A day in which it shall forever, all of the storms, all of the darkness, all every last cloud, forever gone. Not just for a while gone, forever gone. Verse 12, "The wicked plotteth against the just, and gnasheth upon him with his teeth. The Lord shall laugh at him." It's so real to the Lord that it's silly. These people running around our country right now, they're silly to the Lord. You know, we're all fretting about them. We're all worried about them. Are they going to sway the country? What are they going to do? The Lord laughs at them.
Right.
It's ridiculous. Just ridiculous. It's pathetic. He sees the end of it so clearly. But we don't. We just see right now. And that's why we fret and why we worry. "The Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth that his day is coming." That's the difference between the Lord and us, is that he seeth.
Mm-hmm.
He seeth that the day is coming. And we ought to.
Amen.
We ought to see it, but we don't. We ought to see it, but we don't.
Right.
When we can see what God sees, then we can rest.
Amen.
Then we can laugh at some of life's things. When we can see as God sees. Verse 14, "The wicked have drawn out the sword. They have bent their bow. They have cast down the poor and needy to slay such as be of upright conversation. Their sword shall enter their own heart, and their bow shall be broken." They're ready. They think they're just about to have us. And it will bring them to their own end. Verse 16. We quote this all the time. "A little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked."
Amen.
We don't often quote it in context, but we often quote that verse. "A little that a righteous man hath," while he's waiting. In this time in which we're waiting for the Lord to enact his justice, whatever you have is much better than what they have. Use that against that envy that comes into the equation.
Amen.
Verse 17, "For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous." The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their abundance shall be forever. When God turns to his people, their inheritance will be forever.
Amen.
We can't grasp that. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time. In the days of famine they shall be satisfied, but the wicked shall perish. And the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs, they shall consume. Into smoke they shall consume away. The wicked borroweth and payeth not again, but the righteous showeth mercy and giveth. For such as be blessed of him shall inherit the earth, and they that be cursed of him shall be cut off. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord,
Amen.
And he delighteth in his way. Again, I don't know what you're waiting on. Let the Lord order your steps. Commit your way to the Lord in your waiting. Be victorious in your waiting. Be moving forward in your waiting. Be serving God. Be worshiping God. Be doing these things even in your waiting. He mentioned the steps of a good man there in verse 23. Notice verse 24, though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down.
Amen.
You know what? While you're waiting, you might fall. That's the truth. That's just the truth of the matter. And we could enter this in as one of our next points of what to do while you're waiting is to get back up. You may fall. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. At least not by the Lord. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, he may be by the Lord's churches and some of God's people. Sometimes, you know, we utterly cast each other down. In our eyes, we're done with people sometimes. Recognize that that person might be in waiting. They might be in a trial. Mm-hmm. They might be in a storm. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. Verse 25, I've been young and I've been old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread.
Amen.
He said, I've not seen it. What basis do we have not to rest, not to delight, not to do all these things? What basis have we? We don't. Near the end of David's life, he said, there's no basis. I've not found a basis for it. Mm-hmm. He is ever merciful and lendeth. His seed is blessed. Here's our next command, verse 27, depart. Depart. You know, there's some things that we need to leave in our waiting. You know, while we're waiting, something I learned from my mother, it's a good time to clean house. While you're waiting, it's a good time to clean. Got nothing else to do? Clean. Clean house. Start getting rid of the junk that accumulated in the busyness of life while you're waiting. I remember when, and this has happened several times since then. I remember when the Lord called me to preach. I remember when he called me to Northern Michigan. I had just purchased a house. I had it for just a few months. And I had remodeled almost all of it, except for two rooms of it. I had just had my job end. And I knew I was going to move north in a couple of months. Whenever the Lord would sell my house and work out all the details. But my job had just ended. I had no income. I had a house I needed to pay for in the meantime. And I'm waiting for the Lord to sell it to relieve me of that burden that allowed me to go to Northern Michigan. And I'm like, I don't know what to do. I can't go out and get a job because they say, well, what are your plans? I'm like, well, actually, to quit in a couple of weeks. I don't know what to do. And for a little while, I was frozen. I don't know what to do. I do not know what to do.
I began to look around the house and look at those couple other rooms that I hadn't done anything with, and I'm like, I gotta get rid of this house. And I spent the last little bit of money I had, and I finished working on those other couple of rooms. About the time I got done, the Lord sold that house. I never had to make another house payment. Put money in my pocket and gave me some profit off of it and allowed me to minister for several months without considering where any money would have to come from.
Amen.
But it's hard when you're frozen and you have to break through that and you have to go, okay, I still need to move forward somehow. While I wait, I still need to move forward. And we've faced that several times since then in our lives. Times that we're waiting. There's stuff to be done. Clean house. Getting back to verse 27, depart from evil. Look over your life. We all could live a more sanctified life.
Amen.
There's some things that need to be departed from. So while we're waiting, let's get near to the Lord. Let's depart from evil. If we're going to hear God lead us, if we're waiting for instruction, if we're waiting for a message, something from the Lord, wouldn't it serve us well to draw near? Oh, some of the worst times of my life was when I needed the direction of the Lord and I knew I was too far away to hear it.
Right.
There's nothing more miserable than that.
Right.
I'm too far away to hear it. I need to hear right now. There's nothing worse than that. Depart from evil. And there's that word again. And do. And do. Trust and do. We sing the song, trust and obey. Trust and do. Trust and move forward. Trust and keep walking. Depart from evil and do good and dwell forevermore. For the Lord loveth judgment. The Lord just, that the Lord loves that. The Lord delights in that. And if there's ever a time we need the Lord to delight in our life and in our way, it's when we're waiting at something. It's when we're trying to weather a storm. Depart from evil and do good and dwell forevermore, for the Lord loveth judgment and forsaketh not his saints. They are preserved forever. That's already been taken care of. All these, you know, I learned in English, when you're writing a story or you're writing something, keep everything in the same tense. Well, these are not in the same tense. Everything so far has been shall. This is the past tense here. You are. Presently, it's taken care of. It's already happened. You are presently preserved forever. But the seed of David shall be cut off. The righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever. The mouth of the righteous speaketh wisdom, and his tongue talketh of judgment. The law of God is in his heart, and none of his steps shall slide. Notice verse 32. We've alluded to this. The wicked watch over the righteous. They're watching what we do in our waiting. The wicked watcheth the righteous and seeketh to slay him. The Lord will not leave him in his hand nor condemn him when he is judged. Again, we see the command here, wait on the Lord. Keep his way. Don't try to make your own way. I'm guilty of that over and over again. Don't try to make your own way. Wait on the Lord and keep his way. And he shall exalt thee. Just wait for him to pick you up out of this mess. Wait for him to begin to lift you out of this. And he shall exalt thee to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, thou shalt see it. I have seen the wicked in great power spreading himself like a green bay tree, yet he passed away. And lo, he was not. Yea, I saw him, but he could not be found. And this is our last command. And it's very fitting. Mark the perfect man. The complete.
To mark them means to set a watch on them, to examine them. In other words, our last command has to do with the fact that we need to be aware, and we need to remember, and we need to implant it in our mind that God has blessed people on this road. Mark the perfect man, and behold the upright. Behold means to watch or look at, for the end of that man is peace. Our last responsibility in our waiting has to do with remembrance. It has to do with looking around with an eye of faith, looking around at those around us that have gone before, that have weathered the storm, and come through. 1 Timothy, there's a verse that says, I think it's 1 Timothy, it says, behold, we count them happy which endure.
Right.
You know, as you consider all of these people that have weathered storms, Job and our Christian friends around us and all these other examples, we count them happy which endure. When they get out on the other side, we see that they're at peace, that they're happy. And you know what? The world's not. And so our last responsibility is that we have a responsibility to keep track, to keep record, and to keep good records of what God has done.
Amen.
We need to do that. We're very pitiful at doing that. God has worked so many miracles in our lives. We're not good at keeping track of that. You know, a while back you all prayed for Evan. It wasn't much before that you were praying with us for Benjamin. Seems like all of us just about have been to the hospital once or twice since we've been down here. Quite often, we get just a horrible prognosis given to us. Well, we think it could be something like cancer. We're not sure. We get horrible prognoses handed to us, and then later on, the doctors say, well, we don't see anything, it must have been a mistake. How can we never say, oh, they don't see anything, the Lord must have taken care of it?
Right, amen. Well,
the Lord, you know, how many times, in a daily basis, how many times have we never even known that one little cell somewhere in our Bible, or our body, somewhere down inside us, wanted to mutate and become a cancer cell? And God said, no.
Right.
Somewhere down inside us, some little cell collected, and then another one came of that, and more, and they multiplied, and it would have been a tumor. And God said, no.
Amen.
Amen.
How many things like that are in our lives? How many miracles, how many things all through our life? How many times have we sat down and said, I can't make the checkbook work. I just can't. How many times? My wife and I, we've been married 15 years this year. There's hardly been many times that finances weren't hard. There are a few years that they weren't. But there have been many times that there weren't. Never once has the Lord forsaken us.
Amen.
Yes. And so we are commanded in this last command to keep track of what God has done. To look around, to look at other people, and go, you know what? The Bible's right. Look at that person.
Mm-hmm.
Look at their life. Look what's happened. We have a responsibility to keep some accurate records about what God has done in our life, in lives around us. To mark them, to pay attention, behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace. But transgressors shall be destroyed together. The end of the wicked shall be cut off. But the salvation of the righteous is of the Lord. His strength, he is their strength in the time of trouble. Notice verse 40. And the Lord shall.
Amen.
And the Lord shall. Remember that. and the Lord shall.
Amen.
The Lord shall help them and deliver them. He shall deliver them from the wicked and save them because they deserve it. Because they trust Him.
Amen.
That's the only reason. Otherwise, they would have earned it.
Right.
What did He tell Israel in Isaiah 41? He said, "Fear not, thou worm, Jacob. I will help thee. I know you're a worm. It's not stopped me before. I'll still help you, Jacob. And I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." Uphold thee with the right hand of your righteousness? No. I'll uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness.
Amen.
Because they trust in Him. That's why.
Amen.
That's why He'll do it. The Lord shall. Because we're trusting in Him. We're not trusting in anything else. The world has all kinds of things they're trusting in. The wicked that we've seen contrasted all through here, there's all kinds of things they're looking to. But the Lord shall. And He'll do it on His merits.
Amen.
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 Man, what a blessing, I tell you. Those little times of waiting are hard. If you've ever been waiting on the Lord, it can be very difficult. But Lord, we ought to rejoice. You look back and think of all the things the Lord has done for you. Mary Prescott, He brought you home safe. You think that was happen chance? A lot of people died there. That he did what he said he would do. And you know, I was taking care of a lady this week. My students are back in the nursing homes there in Clarksville now. And I saw a lady, much older than me, I think she was in her 30s, who had the exact same procedure that I had 9 years ago, and she's in the nursing home, and I'm here.
Amen.
You know, it's because of goodness of God.
Amen.
You know, and sometimes we wait. Put your faith and strength in the way. It is. Brother Junior, you come, and Donna, we'll have a word for some song. If you wait and have trouble waiting, you know, we all have to wait. The problem is, are you patient in waiting? No. Trust the Lord to do it. As you stand, as you sing.
Page number 63, St. Pastor Novel Channel 63.
Do not pass.
Blair?
Yes.
We'd like to have the fellowship meeting in January. Right. I'll step back to church and no other brother wants.
Right. Sounds good. Any other thing? Pray for my brother-in-law, Christopher, and his wife. They have common issues. They wanted to be here tonight, so pray that everything will work out well there. You know, again, we don't appreciate even being here most of the time. But it's hindered you. All right, any other thing?
Brother Larry?
Yes.
I'm glad to be here this year.
Amen.
About a year ago, I was diagnosed with the cancer, and the Lord's blessed.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, any other thing?
I'm thankful for the rain.
Amen. Amen.
Better than thirsty.
Yep.
Amen.
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 Brother, it's certainly a blessing to be here tonight.
Amen.
I was really blessed with what Mark said, not only with his word, but with the singing.
Amen.
Lifting up our Lord and Savior, what a blessing it is to be here.
Amen.
And saved by God's grace tonight.
Amen. Amen. That's it. Amen. What do you think?
Larry, what would I say? Thank the Lord for all that he's done for me for the last couple, 3 months. And I've had things that had to be adjusted and parts put in and everything like that. But, you know, the Lord, he's blessed me.
Amen.
And he gave me an opportunity to be a witness while I was doing this. And so I thank him for all
Amen.
His blessings.
Amen. He does nothing by chance.
All
right, any other thing? Right, I want to do something I used to do too. I want y'all to, Brother Jimmy, you can too. I want y'all to turn to page 1. Because I almost requested this one while ago instead of page 2. And when Brother Mark said something about it, I wanted to close with it.
Thank you.
Any other thing before we dismiss? There's plenty of food downstairs. We want everybody to stay and get their belly full. Your spirit should be full now and have time of fellowship for us. The most biblical holiday that our nation observes is this week coming.
Amen. Amen.
And I like to always give time for it. The pagans have about taken over everything.
That's right.
So why not give one that's right?
Amen.
Brother Sean, if you would, you dismiss us and bless the food.
Our Father, which art in heaven, we're delighted to have this privilege to be here tonight. Thank you for this church, Brother Larry and his wife, and membership of this church being willing to host the area-wide fellowship. And Father, forgive us for the many times that we take thy blessings upon us for granted. Help us to realize that every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights. With him is no variableness in the shadow of turning. Waiting enables us to be more thankful to thee when provision is made and when answer is given. We have waited patiently for rain. And thou hast sent it.
Yeah.
And Father, we know that thou art the director of the environment.
Yes.
And I thank thee tonight for the water that thou hast sent to enable us to enjoy life. I do pray that thou wouldst bless the food, the nourishment of our bodies. Father, bless the fellowship that we'll have around the table. And for the ladies of this church who have taken their time out of their schedule and perhaps even some of the men to prepare the food for us, I pray that thou wouldst bless them as well. Go with us tonight as we depart. Carry us safely to our homes. And Father, as we arise on tomorrow, if it be thy will, and look forward to worshiping thee on thy day. Help us to make proper preparations and to gather together with a ready sacrifice. These things we ask tonight in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen.